Okay. Hello, everyone. I am Anushka Kapoor. I'm an ocular oncologist at L.V. Prasad Eye Institute, Vijayawada. We welcome you all to our instruction course, Ocular Surface Squamous Neoplasia, our masterclass. So there will be six talks over a span of 1 hour, followed by a 15-minute discussion. So without any further ado, I will start with our first talk for the day. We have the young, dynamic, budding ocular oncologist, a gold medalist from JIPMER, currently an assistant professor in All India Institute of Medical Sciences, Hyderabad, Vijita V.S. Vijita will be talking on imaging in ocular surface squamous neoplasia. Over to you, Vijita.
Thanks for that very kind introduction, Dr. Anusua. Are my slides visible?
Yes, and you are well audible.
Go ahead. Thank you. Okay, good morning to everyone. So let's begin this session on a masterclass on ocular surface squamous neoplasia with my talk on role of imaging in the diagnosis of OSSN. So I have no financial interest, and the images used in this presentation are from my alma mater, the L.V. Prasad Eye Institute. The objectives of my presentation are, firstly, to understand what is the role of imaging modalities in the diagnosis of OSSN, to understand the salient features of OSSN on these, and touch upon the newer imaging modalities as well. So ever since the concept of OSSN was crystallized by Lee and Hurst way back in 1995, a number of imaging modalities have been described, and these include confocal microscopy, optical coherence tomography, ultrasound biomicroscopy, the very interesting OCT angiography, and then the autofluorescence. So as we all know, OSSN presents as a limbal nodule in the interpalpebral location with intrinsic vessels, the hallmark of surface keratin, feeder vessels, and often corneal extension as well. So if the clinical description is so classical, what is the need for imaging? So there are three crystal reasons for the same. And these include, although the nodular and leucoplochic morphology are the most common presentations of OSSN, it can have a variety of presentations mimicking a number of benign disorders such as conjunctivitis, episcleritis, scleritis, name them and you have it. The second important reason is that OSSN can also occur in compromised ocular surfaces such as following chemical injury, corneal scars, in coexistence with microbial keratitis, or in a corneal graft where it is very difficult to pick it up clinically. In addition, there are a number of close mimickers such as biogenic granuloma, pseudoepitheliomatous hyperplasia, and any lesion with speckles of keratin can also look like OSSN. So now how do we know based on clinical diagnosis which is OSSN and which is not when so many look similar? So all of us are familiar with this adage that when in doubt, you cut it out. However, here we have the luxury of performing an imaging and obtaining an optical non-invasive biopsy. Moving on to my next presentation, let's look at the next objective. Let's look at the salient features of OSSN. Confocal microscopy was one of the initial modalities described, and it gives a cellular morphology of the lesion, which helps us pick the malignant cells from the normal ones. The neoplastic cells are enlarged irregular cells with bright hyperreflective nuclei as seen in this part of the image. However, its role has been limited because of poor sensitivity and specificity. Let's move to the ASOCT, which is the most commonly employed imaging modality for diagnosis of OSSN. This is a scan of the normal ocular surface, and towards the left is the conjunctival epithelium covered by a layer of tear film. Now, the tear film is hyperreflective and thin, followed by a mildly hyperreflective conjunctival epithelium, and then the subepithelial layers. Now, the corneal end has a more clearer picture with a thin hyperreflective tear film, followed by hyporeflective and thin corneal epithelium. Deep to that is the stroma with the lamellar architecture. Now, limbus is usually where the OSSN arises, and that is our areas of interest. Let's take a look at this clinical picture, which shows a leukoplakic lesion in the nasal quadrant at the limbus. The corresponding scan through the lesion shows epithelial hyperreflectivity. By that, I mean the increased whiteness of the lesion when compared to the normal corneal epithelium, which is next to it. You may also note that as you trace the epithelium towards the right, there is progressive thickening in the epithelium. Now, bringing your attention to this point where the corneal epithelium look distinctly different from that of the lesion on this side. This is known as the zone of abrupt transition. It's important to remember that not all features are seen in every lesion. In our series of patients, we have seen that epithelial hyperreflectivity is seen in 93% of the OSSN lesions, and 91% show epithelial thickening, and 81% show abrupt transition as well. In other words, all three features were present in 75% of the cases, any two in 23%, which means if you see any two of them, then it is almost seen 98% of the OSSN lesions. Sorry about the animation. Yeah. Another important feature to understand in the interpretation of ASOCT is to know what a shadow effect is. Now, shadow effect is the obscurance of the inner details because of presence of keratin due to the thickness of the lesion or pigmentation. This can affect the visualization of deeper structures, which are the plane of separation and the subepithelium. This yellow dots represent the distinct difference between the epithelium and the subepithelium. Now, as you trace them towards the towards this asterisk, you may note that there is loss of this clear plane of separation. And on histopathology, this corresponds to an island of invasion. Cystoid spaces. Though these were characteristically described in conjunctival nevus, and a pigmented lesion can be confused with one in the absence of keratin. Cystoid spaces in OSSN can be of two types, those which are small and hyporeflective, and these correspond to blood vessels within the lesion. They can also be larger and polygonal with hyperreflective foci within, and these correspond to necrotic cellular material on histopathology. Now, either of these can be seen in invasive and intraepithelial disease. Now that we have understood what is seen in OSSN, let's look at what is not OSSN. So this limbal plaque does look like OSSN, but on ASOCT, you can observe that the subepithelium is the area which is maximally thickened. The epithelium is fairly thin, although with some hyperreflectivity. Pseudoepitheliomatous hyperplasia, which occurs in existing allergies, is also a close mimicker of OSSN. And what we need to look for is this characteristic epithelial dips that correspond to the same on histopathology. Squamous papilloma also can mimic OSSN, but the blood vessels usually show a radiating pattern. Moving on to OCT angiography, although this directly does not add any value to the diagnosis of OSSN, the vascular patterns do seem to have some role in planning the management of the disease. Now, OCT does have its own limitations, which are due to the thickness of the lesion, presence of pigment or keratin as seen in this picture, which obscures the visualization of the deeper aspect of the lesion. Whenever the posterior extent of the lesion cannot be visualized and there is a strong clinical suspicion of invasion, it's important to perform an ultrasound biomicroscopy. Now, this lesion in the ASOCT does not show the deeper details because of back shadowing, whereas the ultrasound biomicroscopy shows invasion into the sclera as well as the ciliary body. Before I conclude, I will touch upon this concept of autofluorescence. When cells undergo a malignant transformation, there are significant alterations in the cell metabolism, which cause variation in the levels of protoporphyrin, NAD, and FAD. And this results in a specific spectral signature that is employed in autofluorescence. In vitro, OSSN has been shown to have a different spectral signature from normal conjunctival epithelium. And in this, by using a technique of false color coding and artificial intelligence, the margins of the lesion could be exactly mapped. This technique has been showed some utility in vivo as well. But its role as of now is limited to diffuse recurrent lesions which have been on medical management, wherein it helps identify specific foci amongst the diffuse lesion, which could be probably active tumor, thus avoiding a need for a biopsy. To summarize, ASOCT followed by UBM are the most commonly used imaging modalities in the diagnosis of OSSN. Typical features of OSSN on ASOCT are a must know for every ophthalmologist, and these include epithelial hyperreflectivity, thickening, and abrupt transition from normal epithelium. UBM aids in the detection of invasive disease when it extends to sclera or intraocularly. Autofluorescence is an emerging treatment modality, which is useful in diffuse and recurrent lesions. Thank you for your patience. Any queries are welcome.
Thank you, Vijita, for that crisp and visually pleasing presentation. Next, we will move on to Dr. Anirban Bhaduri. He is an LVPI alumnus and presently the head of the Department of Oculoplasty and Ocular Oncology at Shushrut Eye Foundation, Kolkata. Over to you, Dr. Anirban.
Thanks, Anushua, for the introduction. I'll just get my slides. Are they visible?
Not yet. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, it is visible now and you are audible. Go ahead.
Thank you. So I would just be talking about my top 10 pearls for the surgical management of OSSM. And Vijita very nicely outlined what modern imaging can do. And that would be a very good modality to decide which are the patients you would not do topical chemotherapy to. So surgery has been the gold standard for the management of OSSM. And every patient is operable unless it crosses certain limits where it becomes rendered inoperable. We'll come to that, of course. So when you are treating an OSSN, please treat it like a cancer, because that exactly is what it is. And you have to respect oncology principles. You have to look for clear margins so that you don't have recurrence. That is the main purpose of the surgery. It's not just cut it and remove it. And the principle that is used here is a wide excision biopsy, along with alcohol keratoepithelectomy to the corneal epithelium here, and beyond the excised margins.
This is please put on your slides on slides mode, sir.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Yeah?
Okay. Yes, sir. Continue, sir.
Okay, so which are the cases you would operate upon? Vijita very nicely showed the cases. The purpose of the imaging where you should not be giving topical chemotherapy, right? So every patient would have been operable except when you have certain situations. It doesn't matter how big it is, provided it doesn't involve the orbit or it doesn't have intraocular invasion. And these are signs that you must look for. When you're doing a clinical examination, look for scleral fixity. You would definitely not give topical chemotherapy there, right? Okay. Once you know, you've seen the patient, done a thorough examination, stain the surface with rose bengal or lissamine green, make a good drawing, because this drawing is also going to be useful in planning your surgery, and this is something you need to hang in the operation theater as well. So pre-operative preparation, what would you do? We use brimonidine eye drops. That's been a game changer, reduces the bleed during surgery. When you're giving anesthesia, avoid chemosis. So either give a gentle peribulbar block or do a retrobulbar block as I do. Staining helps in deciding the extent of your excision. and have a bipolar cautery at hand to handle the feeder vessels. So the next very important thing, of course, is the wide excision. So we take 4 millimeter margins and you mark it out on the patient's eye. I use a gentian violet pen for the purpose. So this is 4 millimeters beyond the visible margin of the tumor. If you had done staining, then it would be beyond the stained edges as well. And you can either do sharp dissection with steel scissors, or you could use a monopolar probe for the same purpose. This is a patient who had a recurrent tumor with scleral fixity. So there's a lot of dissection in the tenons, which is fibrotic here. The second margin that you have to look at is also the base of the tumor. So an oocyst is a three-dimensional structure, right? It has thickness as well. So you need to get clear margins at the base. And in a situation like this, where you have scleral involvement, you need to do a lamellar sclerectomy. So this is what we're doing. With a crescent knife, about 20% thickness of the sclera is being removed along with the tumor. And when you're doing this dissection, you can very nicely see the fibers of the collagen fibers on the sclera, so that you know you're actually removing the tumor as well and leaving clear sclera behind. And this is the way you progress up to the limbus. Okay, the other important principle is you're not going to touch the tumor. This entire surgery involves doing what is known as a no-touch technique. So this is a video from a colleague. And you can see that the margin is, the edge of the margin is being held during the surgical manipulation. There is no contact whatsoever with the tumor which is present here. And this is what usually happens. If there is no scleral fixity, the tumor would lift up very nicely along with the conjunctiva and the scleral tissues. Then we come to this edge. How do you handle that? So we do what is known as alcohol keratoepithelectomy. So I'm just drying out the corneal surface now and then applying absolute alcohol. And once you've applied alcohol, you will notice that the epithelium becomes gray. And then about 2 millimeters of epithelium from the visible margin is then scrolled off towards the limbus. This is how we go ahead with the corneal margin. Okay, what about the limbus? The limbus is the one place where conjunctiva is adherent to the sclera. So that's a 2 millimeter wide base that we have. And this is where you need to employ sharp dissection. So you do the sharp dissection and a helpful assistant would irrigate so that, you know, any blood that would come into your field would be removed. Okay, then comes cryotherapy to the edge of the conjunctiva. So the residual edge that you're leaving behind, you're creating a further collar of safety by doing cryotherapy. And this is done from the underside of the conjunctiva. You do 2 cycles of double freeze thaw cryotherapy. And the purpose of doing it from the underside is so that you're knowingly treating the entire thickness of conjunctiva. Now, how do you close the surface? There are several ways of doing it. You can either do a primary closure if it's a smaller lesion. And what we do nowadays, a change in our practices, we also take care to close the tenons capsule. So the tenons capsule has been dissected here so that we can get a better closure. This would create an additional barrier just in case you have a recurrence from the margins. And it's amazing how much of ocular surface can actually be closed by a primary closure. Where you have more extensive disease, you can also, of course, use an amniotic membrane graft, as in this patient who had scleral involvement here. And in very extensive disease where you anticipate stem cell loss, then you can also do a limbal stem cell transplant. This is a pre-interferon patient where we have given 2 cycles of mitomycin C to chemoreduce. And then we did a wide excision here, which involved removing most of the limbus anyways. And this is after the limbal stem cell graft, which was taken from the other eye. Nowadays, of course, you can do a SLET. The next important thing is, of course, how do you send the sample? The sample needs to be laid out on filter paper in a way that It is oriented just the way it was in the patient side, so that the pathologist knows which are the margins, you know, from their interpretation, which are the margins that you need to go back and take care of subsequently. So you lay it out and spread it out on the filter paper, leave it to dry. Only then will it stick to the filter paper. And then you send it in 10% formula. Okay. It doesn't end with the surgery alone. So you have to, so these patients are given topical steroids and antibiotics. I use fluoromethylone now. And you have to wait and see what the histopathology report says. If the edge is reported as positive, either dysplastic or invasive, then you can think about giving topical chemotherapy, or you can observe. Since you've done cryotherapy beyond the margin, that is one option. If you keep the patient on a close observation, any recurrence, and you can start treating again. So that's one option. If the base, however, is involved, these patients would need plaque brachytherapy once the surface has healed. And this is one such patient where we've done the surgery in Calcutta, and then Dr. Kalikiri Swati, she did the plaque brachytherapy, and the patient is doing well now after 2 years. And you have to keep these patients on follow-up visits. See, you're dealing with a malignant tumor, right? So these patients would be on follow-up care for the rest of their lives, because there is a small chance of recurrence. If you follow these techniques, it's about a 5% chance of recurrence. And the way we do it is we follow up these patients every 3 months for the first 1 year, every 6 months for the next 3 years, and then yearly thereafter, unless there is a recurrence, of course. So just to summarize, surgery still remains the gold standard of treatment for OSSM, provided you follow the oncosurgical principles. And if you do careful planning, you pay meticulous attention to detail, you will have good post-operative results. So just follow the pulse, that's all.
Thank you, Anirvan, for those excellent pearls on surgical management of OSSM.
Thank you, Anusha, for inviting me.
So if you can stop sharing your screen.
I'll do that. So how do I do that is the next question. Stop share. Okay. Sorry. Okay, I'm out.
Okay. So, is my screen visible?
Yes.
Yes, Anaswa.
Okay. So, my topic is immunotherapy in OSSN. So, a typical OSSN looks like this. So, it is a limbal nodule with an interpalpebral location with intrinsic vascularity, surface keratin, feeder vessels, and a corneal involvement. So, having understood that, in the next few minutes, I will be taking you through the 10 key aspects of immunotherapy in OSSM. So the first description of use of interferon in OSSM was in the year 1994 by Maskin et al. They used topical interferon successfully in a case of conjunctival intraepithelial neoplasia. So what are interferons? Interferons are a group of glycoproteins produced by leukocytes, which have anti-proliferative, antiviral, cytotoxic, anti-angiogenic, and immunomodulatory effects. So what are the advantages over surgical excision, which Anirban just now described? So the advantages are reduced risk of limbal stem cell deficiency, the side effects of surgery which can happen like pseudopterygium formation, corneal opacity are not there here. Treatment of microscopic disease possible. I think this is Anirban's timer. Okay, so treatment of microscopic disease and reduce chances of recurrences theoretically, but it also has certain disadvantages, like it needs to be compounded freshly, it needs refrigeration, it requires multiple follow-up visits from the patient, and long-term compliance of the patient is extremely important when you start a patient on immunotherapy. So although nowadays many of us use immunotherapy as the primary treatment modality in the majority of our OSSM patients, there are three indications where it has definite advantage over surgery. So I will be listing them one by one. So what do I mean by immunoreduction? Immunoreduction is to reduce the tumor size to facilitate surgical excision So this is for extensive or diffuse OSSNs with basal diameter more than 15 millimeter or more than 6 clock hours of limbal involvement.
Ma'am, next please, is, on your video.
My video is not on. But my video,
no, ma'am.
Here it is showing as switched on. I don't know. But the slides are visible, right?
Yes, we can see the slides. We can see you also.
Yeah, so it's switched on here.
Yes, so, ma'am. So now it's on.
So immunotherapy is sole treatment where we use interferon as a sole treatment for tumor regression, majorly in cases of predominantly corneal OSSN, like you see in this patient, a predominantly corneal OSSN completely regressing on interferon therapy. For smaller conjunctiva or conjunctivo corneal OSSN, it can be used. For recurrent tumors, it can be used. So in immunoprevention, to prevent tumor recurrence, like Anirvan mentioned, like we have a protocol-based immunotherapy post-surgical excision. Whenever the surgical margins are positive, we use interferon for a duration of 3 months to prevent tumor recurrence. So the dosage varies from institute to institute. It ranges from 1 million international unit to 10 million international unit. This is what we are using at our institute right now. For topical, we use a dose of 1 million international unit per ml, one drop, 4 times daily. So it is continued at least 3 months beyond the clinical resolution of the tumor. For subconjunctival injection, it comes as a pre-filled syringe. The entire prefilled syringe is injected subconjunctivally. So the advantage of injection over drops are ensured patient compliance, quicker resolution, no compounding is required, and at times insurance coverage. So I will be taking you through this video where I show you how to prepare topical interferon eye drop. So on the stick, aseptic precautions, we prepared this. So this is the prefilled syringe of 5 million international unit. I'm emptying it in a sterile vial. I'm taking distilled water, 4 ml. Which is again being emptied into the same vial. So here, patients in private practice, they also use the lubricants which are available. In the lubricant vial only, they prepare it. So we hand this over to the patient with the date marked on it in a thermocol vial, placing ice packs there so that the temperature is maintained. And we instruct the patient to keep them in the door of the refrigerator, and monthly they come for the medication. So next, moving on to the injection technique for interferon. How do we inject? So this is done under topical anesthesia. A drop of proparacaine is being instilled. You can see the lesion there. So the prefilled syringe is being injected subconjunctivally without touching the tumor. And you can see this bleb nicely raising all around. We need to take care that we do not go through a vessel, then there will be subconjunctival hemorrhage in the post-op period. So the cost is, we are very fortunate that way, that the cost is, it is very cheap in India compared to the West. Each syringe cost us around 800 rupees, and the average cost for 6 cycles is around 9,700. An additional cost of 800 will be there for each injection that we give. So it is very well tolerated in our patients. There can be mild side effects like irritation and stinging sensation, some conjunctival hyperemia or follicular conjunctivitis or SPKs. Systemic symptoms like flu-like symptoms, fever, myalgia can happen with injections. The 8th pearl here is long-term follow-up is very important in all these patients. While on treatment, every monthly they need to come to us. Post-resolution also they need to be on a strict follow-up regimen. What we do here is 3 monthly for a year, 4 monthly second year, 6 monthly third year, and yearly at least for a duration of 5 years. So a literature review shows that the response rate is very good, 80 to 100% with immunotherapy, the mean resolution time being 4 months, and the recurrence rate is around 8%. As you can see in this patient, it's a one-eyed patient where it has resolved completely only on 3 cycles of interferon therapy. So the 10th pearl is very important when not to consider immunotherapy. Whenever the diagnosis is in doubt, best is to perform incision biopsy, establish your diagnosis, and then start on immunotherapy. When the depth is in doubt, or it is a T3 stage tumor, that is, there is involvement of the adjacent structures, intraocular, cornea, fornix, tarsus, punctum, lid. When any of the adjacent structures are involved, we cannot give immunotherapy. Patient compliance is extremely important for starting a patient on immunotherapy. So we need to talk to the patient and clearly explain to them the need for long-term follow-up. And we don't give interferon routinely post-surgery. We only give when it is indicated, when the margins are positive. So with this, as I'm nearing to the end of my presentation, the points to retain from this presentation are: the interferon are glycoproteins with antineoplastic properties. The absolute indications of interferon over surgery are immunotherapy in corneal OSSNs, immunoreduction in diffuse large OSSNs, and immunoprevention when the margins are positive post-excision biopsy. The dosage varies, topical 1 million international unit and subconjunctival 5 million international unit is what we are using. We give it at least for 3 months after complete tumor regression to take care of the microscopic residues. Long-term follow-up post-resolution is of utmost importance. The advantages of medical therapy include ability to treat the entire ocular surface and the potential to avoid stem cell deficiency associated with extensive surgical excisions. The average time for clinical resolution is 4 months. Thank you everyone for patient listening. Any query, you can mail me on this ID or you can WhatsApp me. So with this, I will stop sharing. So the next presentation is by my mentor, astute clinician and a prolific researcher, Dr. Swati Kaliki. She heads our Operation Eyesight Universal Institute for Eye Cancer, LV Prasad Eye Institute. Over to you, Swati, for your presentation on management of recurrent OSSN.
Thank you very much, Anuswa. And first of all, thank you for organizing this instruction course. And I'm very happy to see a lot of LVP alumni and those with whom I've been associated with probably teaching or mentoring. Really happy to see that. So I'll be talking about management of recurrent OSSN. One second. Yeah, so first of all, I do not have any financial disclosures, and a consent has been taken for use of patient's clinical photograph. Now, the recurrence of ocular surface squamous neoplasia, it does occur. All of us who practice OSSN treatment have experienced to see the patients having recurrences. And it has been reported that after excisional biopsy, the range of recurrence can be between 0 to almost 60%. With mitomycin C, the upper limit is about 35%, 5-fluorouracil much more, being about 40%. And with interferon, at this point of time, it is about 10%. But probably the interferon being a newer modality of treatment, the long-term results might be different. Now, talking about the recurrence of OSSN after surgical excision, I think this is a very informative paper that came from Bascom Palmer, where they studied what are the risk factors or the predictors that can suggest that the patient is likely to have a recurrence after excision biopsy. And these are the things that are important. That is, whenever the patient has a higher AJCC staging, that means if the patient has a T2 or T3 tumor, they are 2 times at higher risk of developing recurrence compared to T1 tumor. And tumor location, again, the tarsal location, whenever it is there, they have higher chances of recurrence. Whenever the surgical margins are involved, they have higher rates of recurrence. And cryotherapy, when not used, can cause recurrence, and higher histopathology grade, like invasive squamous cell carcinoma versus a dysplasia, they are, the patients with invasive lesion are, have more chances of having the recurrence. But if we go back into the literature, I feel the most important publication that came out in this is this paper, which came out in about 1986, where they studied different factors, and they showed that neither the tumor morphology or the cell type or the degree of dysplasia actually influence the tumor recurrence. It is mostly the tumor margin. And they showed that whenever the tumor margins are involved, the risk of recurrence is as high as 50%, which can be reduced to 5% when there are tumor-free margins. Now, this is another paper, an interesting paper, which came from an African group where they actually did wide excision biopsy, did not use cryotherapy because of non-availability. And they showed that the tumor recurrence rate is still only 3%. So this paper, I think this tells us that tumor margins are much more important than cryotherapy. Yes, cryotherapy can minimize recurrence, but the most important is acquiring free tumor margins. And whenever we do not use adjuvant therapy after surgical excision, if there is an indication for adjuvant treatment, these patients again are at higher risk of developing tumor recurrence. Now, how do we minimize recurrence? It's always prevention is better than cure. So we have to minimize recurrence by, first of all, choosing the cases wisely. We have to know which are the cases which are suitable for excisional biopsy, or should we attempt alternate modalities of treatment. Avoid iatrogenic tumor seeding. One is the most common mistake that surgeons do is keep on flushing the globe when they're doing surgery. Always try to maintain a dry field. Do not keep on pouring saline during surgery. That itself can cause tumor seeding. And second thing is using two different sets of instruments. Change the instruments. Do not use contaminated instruments in the non-tumor area. And try to get the tumor-free margins by taking wide margins, use cryotherapy and appropriate adjuvant treatment. Now, here are examples where a small lesion and a relatively larger lesion where we are able to get a good treatment response where there is no recurrence, but that may not be so in all cases. Like here is an example where the patient had tumor recurrence within 3 months. And here you can see the lesion is in the area of previous tumor. Now, here is an example where the patient had a tumor in the temporal area, which was excised. The superior area was absolutely normal at that time, but the patient came back with tumor recurrence at a different site 5 years later. So we have to do a good examination to identify recurrences. Now, we also see recurrences after medical treatment. Now, this is an important paper where they showed that the recurrence rate of OSSN is similar either with surgery or with interferon treatment. And when we compare the response of IFU and interferon, the results are similar, including the recurrence rates. And this is one paper where we try to see what are the factors that can influence recurrence after medical treatment. And it is mainly the size of the tumor which determines whether the patient can have tumor recurrence. Now, here are some examples where they have very good response. This is after 5FU, where the tumor completely regressed. And this is where we used interferon and there is complete tumor regression. But again, that may not be the case with all cases. Like in this case, we used interferon. He did very well with just 3 months of treatment. But 3 years later, he came back with a tumor recurrence. So recurrences can occur after medical treatment. So how do we go about treating these cases? Now, first of all, before we start treatment, it is very important to confirm the diagnosis, rule out if there is any extension, and do appropriate investigative modalities. Now, here is an example where the patient underwent excision and came back with this lesion, and the patient was concerned that there is recurrence. But is this truly a recurrence? Now, this is the OCT, which shows that it does not have any features that Vijita described in the first presentation. So if we compare it with OSSN, where we see that abrupt transition and the hyperreflectivity and the lesion being epithelial, all those are missing in this. So the first one, of course, that is just an example of how the OCT OSSN looks. And this is not OSSN. This, the one that the patient presented to us with, is just a simple pyogenic granuloma and not a OSSN. Now, here is another example, the same patient that I showed you before. Now, this patient underwent excision biopsy for the recurrent tumor and then came back with this lesion. And the patient again was very concerned that this is recurrence. Now, is this recurrence? Definitely not. This is just a corneosclerosis cyst that has occurred at the surgical site. And the OCT confirms the presence of the cystic spaces. Now, this is an interesting case where the patient had undergone, had history of OSSN in both eyes, underwent excision biopsy and came back with this lesion. If we see closely, there is a corneal lesion that is present in the right eye and the left eye doesn't look like that there is recurrent OSSN. Now, let's just see OCT to confirm the diagnosis. So this is the first case and you can see that there is abrupt transition between the hyperreflective epithelium and the normal epithelium, confirming that there is OSSN recurrence in the right eye. But this is the left eye. Left eye, you see that the lesion is in the, it's in the, in between the stroma and the epithelium. So this is just a corneal opacity that is present and it is not OSSN. So the right eye is recurrent OSSN while the left eye is simple corneal opacity. Now this patient came back with recurrent OSSN and appropriate imaging is important. As can be seen, this patient on UBM showed intraocular extension. And this is a patient where underwent excision biopsy, underwent extended enucleation was doing fine, but 8 months later came back with a suspicious lesion. So in fact, this patient had recurrent OSSN and which was extending deep into the orbit. So it is always important to do appropriate investigations to know the extent of the lesion. Why is it important? Because the treatment of recurrent OSSN, you can use the similar modalities of treatment like you use for primary treatment, but the extent of the lesion should be very clear. Now, this is an example where the patient had recurrent OSSN after interferon treatment. He was not compliant to treatment. So we went ahead and did simple excisional biopsy and he did fine. So excisional biopsy is a good treatment modality for recurrent OSSN. Now, this is another patient who had multiple recurrences after surgery, and we combined it with SLET because he had extensive involvement and he again did fine. Now, when do we use PRAC radiotherapy for recurrent OSSN? So this is an example where there are multiple recurrences after surgery and we can combine excision biopsy and PRAC radiotherapy and they do fine. And this is one more patient who had recurrence after excisional biopsy. And this, it was a very ill-defined lesion histopathology, confirmed recurrent OSSN. We directly did PRAC radiotherapy and he did fine. Now, this is a patient who had recurrent OSSN after excision biopsy elsewhere. And you can see it is extensive lesion. We used interferon alpha 2B and you can see that excellent response with medical treatment. So medical treatment, again, is a very good treatment option for these patients. Here is an example where 5-fluorouracil was used in this patient because he did not respond to repeated excisions and interferon. He mainly had the corneal disease. And after two cycles of 5-FU, you can see that his cornea has become clear and the disease completely resolved. Now, extended enucleation is required whenever there is intraocular extension, like in this case. And orbital excentration may be required in some cases like this, where this patient underwent enucleation, came back with orbital recurrence, as can be seen on imaging, and he underwent orbital excentration. So any modality of treatment can be used for recurrence. We have to use appropriate treatment and good examination is important. So with this, I complete my talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Swati, for that lucid, enlightening talk. Next, I invite Dr. Soumya Jakati. Soumya is a faculty with us at the Ophthalmic Pathology Services at Elvi Prasad Eye Institute, Hyderabad. Over to you, Soumya, for your presentation on histopathology of OSSN.
Is my screen visible, Dr. Anushul?
Yes, Soumya, go ahead.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. So today I'll be speaking on the histopathology of ocular surface squamous neoplasias. So my basic objectives here would be to understand the normal histology of conjunctiva, the various classification of OSSNs, histopathological features of individual OSSN, and to summarize them. So normal conjunctival epithelium is composed or is lined by non-keratinizing stratified squamous epithelium with the presence of globular cells. So ocular surface squamous neoplasias encompasses a spectrum of lesions which include mild dysplasia, moderate dysplasia, severe dysplasia, carcinoma in situ and invasive component, that is squamous cell carcinoma along with its variants. So how do we fix transport and what are the grossing modalities we use? So as Dr. Arniban explained, that we have to place the resected conjunctival specimen on a filter paper, allow it to dry for about a minute, and then send it to pathology laboratory in 10% neutral buffered formalin. All the other specimens like enucleation and excentrations must be sent in 10% neutral buffered formalin. You have to ensure that the markings over the on the filter paper should be appropriate and label the sites precisely. So this is a scanner view of the ocular surface squamous neoplasia, wherein we have the normal conjunctiva, the lesion, which shows cellular stratification and loss of polarity, and the base of the lesion, which is very essential because that is the area which has to be examined precisely. This is on higher magnification, where we can see an abrupt transition from the normal epithelium to the neoplastic epithelium. So in mild dysplasias, what we can see is there is cellular atypia in the basal one-third of the epithelium, wherein you will have nuclear enlargement, nuclear pleomorphism, irregular nuclear membranes, and nuclear hyperchromasia. In moderate dysplasia, the atypia is seen in the basal two-thirds of the epithelium, and there is no invasion into underlying stroma. In severe dysplasia, we have full thickness atypia with surface maturation. The superficial layer of the squamous cell is intact and there is no invasion into the underlying stroma. Whereas in carcinoma in situ, what we can see is full thickness atypia with loss of surface maturation. In carcinoma in situ, as we know, there would be no invasion into underlying stroma. Apart from that, you can also find features of spheroidal degeneration and elastotic degeneration in the underlying subepithelial stroma. So to rule out periodic acid shift or the past stain is used to rule out invasion. In case where we have a dilemma that whether there is invasion or not, we can use past stain to determine that, because invasion causes breach in the basement membrane. And surface maturation is because of the presence of glycogen in the non-neoplastic superficial squamous cells, which is seen specifically in dysplasias and is lost in carcinoma in situ. In squamous cell carcinoma, there will be obvious infiltration into the subepithelial stroma. And you have to also look for minute details with precision, wherein you will have minimal or microscopic invasion, stromal invasion. There is also something called a single cell infiltration, wherein single cells, neoplastic cells, break off and infiltrate into the stroma. The various patterns in squamous cell carcinoma includes quads and trabeculae with keratin pearl formation. There can be insular pattern or wherein the lesion appears in islets surrounded by dense fibroblastic stroma. And there can be comedonecrosis, wherein there is a central area of necrosis surrounded by the lesional cells. Now, individual lesional cells are large, polygonal, with moderate to abundant cytoplasm and intracytoplasmic keratinization. You can also find intracytoplasmic pigment in this. Whenever you find pigment, clinically, the differential diagnosis vary between a melanoma and a pigmented basal cell carcinoma. You can have a differentials of that. And nuclear morphology, you can have marked pleomorphism. You'll have hyperchromatic to vesicular nucleus with irregular nuclear membrane and a very prominent nucleoli. Occasionally, you can find bizarre nuclei seen. The intercellular bridges, which are nothing but the desmosomes between individual squamous cells, which are prominent in squamous cell carcinoma. Atypical mitosis and dyskeratotic cells, in which there is keratinization in a single cell. These are common features which are seen in squamous cell carcinoma. You can also have coilocytic change, which is nothing but infection with HPV, wherein you have a halo around perinuclear halo and a dense condensation of deep eosinophilic cytoplasm in the periphery. Adjacent to the main lesion, you can also find chronic inflammation, multinucleate giant cell reaction to the keratin, and elastotic degeneration. The variants of squamous cell carcinoma include a spindle cell variant, wherein you'll find fascicles of spindle cells, neoplastic spindle cells, and mucoepidermoid carcinoma, wherein you'll have mucin-filled vacuoles along with the epidermoid cells and the intermediate cell. And that mucin is passed, is positive on Alcian blue. So we have to precisely examine the margins and the base of the lesions. So you have to carefully look at the margin. The base of the here in this photomicrograph, the base of the specimen is not involved. Whereas in this photomicrograph, as you can see, the base of the specimen is involved. Whenever we have large conjunctival resections, you'll have separate margin set. So in this particular case, you have the normal conjunctiva and the infiltration of the lesional cells seen in the subepithelial stroma. So whenever you suspect intraocular extension, you enucleate the samples. And this is a hole mount view of the anterior segment of the enucleation, wherein you have lesion. And on deeper sections, you can see there is involvement of the lesion into the ciliary body and into the Schlemm's canal. So to summarize, whenever we look at the lesion, you look at the architectural pattern, cytological atypia, cytological morphology, differentiation. And when you're looking at the margins and the base, you look at the presence or absence of malignant cells. And I would like to acknowledge my team, pathology team at LVPI. Thank you.
Thank you, Soumya, for a wonderful presentation. So I will be now taking up on what Savari was supposed to present, masquerades of OSSL. So is my slide visible?
Yes, Anushka.
Okay. So we have already understood the typical appearance of OSSL. So the morphology of OSSN can be variable. Like it can be papillary, gelatinous, pigmented, leukoplakic, nodular, nodulo-ulcerative, diffuse, orbital, corneal. But it is important to know about these different morphologic subtypes so that we don't miss on any of their presentation. So as Vijita has nicely demonstrated, the typical features of OSSN on ASOCT, thickened hyperreflective epithelium, abrupt transition, and the tissue plane of separation from the underlying stroma. Having understood the typical presentation, let us now see what are the different lesions which can masquerade an OSSN. So the epithelial surface tumors can be squamous papilloma, pseudoepitheliomatous, hyperplasia, keratoacanthoma, nevus or a melanoma, stromal tumors like pyogenic granuloma, lymphoma, or a dermoid, different degenerations like pterygium pingicula, or other conjunctival and corneal pathologies like conjunctivitis, microbial keratitis, corneal scars. So now I will take you through a series of cases and give you the highlighting points by which you can differentiate it from OSSN. So a squamous papilloma can be very similar to a papillary variant of OSSN, but they usually don't have the typical feeder vessels. So feeder vessels are dilated, tortuous conjunctival vessels which dip into the tumor. So feeder vessels are not there. They also usually don't have surface keratin. However, on ASOCT, they look very similar to OSSN. And the final diagnostic conclusion can often be derived on histopathology. So keratoacanthoma can again be a mimicker of OSSN. So it is usually a dome-shaped lesion with a central crater of keratin adjacent to the limbus. But we need to take all precautions like we take in OSSN for these lesions for the surgical excision, because many a times they have an underlying squamous cell carcinoma. Pseudoepitheliomatous hyperplasia, they have a typical history of preceding ocular surface inflammation or an allergy. And on everting the eyelids, you can see these the signs of allergy with this papillae there, and many a times you can see on ASOCT the typical sign of an epithelial dipping. and it is predominantly a subepithelial lesion. So moving on to the melanocytic conjunctival tumors, the nevus have the, they're usually limited to the limbus and they usually have the cysts in them. And they can be confused with the pigmented OSSN. Melanomas, they are much elevated, have a corneal component to it. It is important to look at the surrounding pigmentation, the feeder vessels. On ASOCT, nevus is a subepithelial lesion and you can see the cyst clearly demonstrated there. Melanoma again is a much elevated subepithelial lesion without the cyst. Conjunctival lymphoma are usually very typical. They have the salmon patch appearance, smooth, diffuse, slightly elevated. And on ASOCT, it appears as a hyporeflective subepithelial lesion. Pyogenic granuloma, they have the typical history of a preceding surgery or trauma. They're often pedunculated, richly vascularized lesion, bleeding on touch. Pterygiums may at times be confused with OSSN, mostly when they are inflamed or in cases of recurrent lesions over a pterygium. But they usually have a regular edge compared to OSSN, where the edges are usually fimbriated. They have triangular, it's a triangular lesion with flatter linear blood vessels. And on ASOCT, it is a plencher, it's a subepithelial lesion with a near normal epithelium. Pingecula similarly with congestion, a few times it can be a mimicker of OSSN, but there are no feeder vessels and again it's a subepithelial lesion. Conjunctivitis can be confused with a diffuse OSSN. So the other mimicker can be for necrotizing scleritis, a nodulo ulcerative OSSN can many a times mimic necrotizing scleritis, but there we need to focus on the surrounding area. It has a indurated thickened conjunctiva with feeder vessels adjoining this area of dehiscence of the conjunctiva and the sclera. So epithelial best friend membrane dystrophy corneal scars can mimic a corneal OSSN, but here the trick is look at the lesion from under the high magnification, and the edges have usually a fimbriated or a heaped up appearance. Even the rose bengal staining comes handy in these cases to delineate the edges. So OSSN can be there coexistent with microbial keratitis. So you will have to note the presence of OSSN because it can have fatal consequences. So both the lesion needs to be noted and treated appropriately. So that's summarizing squamous papilloma, keratoacanthoma, pseudoepitheliomatous hyperplasia, nevus, melanoma, lymphoma, pyogenic granuloma, pterygium, pingecula, conjunctivitis, necrotizing scleritis, corneal scar can all mimic. Okay. We need to remember the clenching signs there. Thank you all for a patient listening. Any queries, you can mail me. So with that, we come to the end of the presentations. We have 15 minutes in hand. We will like to take questions. So starting with you, Vijita, you have clearly demonstrated the imaging findings of OSSN. So how does time domain OCT compare with spectral domain OCT in OSSN lesions? And people who don't have a SD OCT at their disposal, can time domain OCT also help?
Yes, thanks for the question, Dr. Anuswa. So as seen, like in my presentation, most of the pictures are SD OCT, but time domain does show more or less similar findings. The advantages of SD OCT are that it offers a better axial as well as lateral resolution. So the images are much clearer. But having said that, time domain also has an advantage that the depth of the lesion can be seen a little better than the SD OCT at a compromise of the resolution.
Okay, thanks, Vijita. I would also like to ask you how, like, can you explain to our audience that how does a high resolution and the ultra high resolution OCT differ?
Yes. So ultra high resolution is like very, very rarely available. What we have SD OCT is what is the high resolution. So time domain has a axial resolution of 10 microns. And spectral domain is better than that, and it offers a resolution of 5 to 7 or up to 5 in the best of the cases. Ultra high resolution offers a resolution of about up to 1 micron of axial resolution. So that is how they differ, the clarity of the image and the clarity is what translates the resolution to.
Okay, Vijita. So Swati, I would like to ask you here, is ultra high resolution OCT commercially available?
Yeah. Thank you, Anasua. So the ultra high resolution that has been described, like you would see in the literature, mostly from the Carol Karp's group at Baskin Palmer. So at this point of time, they got it modified so that it can be used for these cases. It is not commercially available as of now. Most of the practices still continue to use the 5 microns resolution time domain OCT itself, the spectral domain OCT itself. The ultra high resolution for now, only one group is using, so not commercially available for now.
Okay, thank you, Swati. So my next question is for Anirban. Anirban, I would like you to think about a scenario where we have operated on a patient and the margin shows invasive squamous cell carcinoma. So I would like to generate some discussion there that are we justified in giving immunotherapy for a period of 3 months in these cases, because we know immunotherapy doesn't work that well for these invasive squamous invasive SCCs here. So should we go ahead and do a repeat excision of the margin, which is better said than done? So what are your views on that?
Sure. Thank you for that question. So if you had invasive squamous cell carcinoma at your margin, right, what you have done is you've created a further zone of cryotherapy beyond your excision. That would have been expected to take care of some of the margin. So interferon or mitomycin C would not be expected to work beyond the basement membrane is what we understand as of now. So one option is to wait and look, keep the patient on observation, look for a recurrence and then treat that, or go ahead and do a repeat cryotherapy. What would be your take on this, Swati?
Yeah, thanks,
Anirban.
I think First of all, Anuswa, it's very unlikely that we get invasive tumor at the margins because it has been shown in studies, it has been shown that on histopathology, what you clinically observe is the limit of the tumor, especially if it is invasive. The margins, if it is positive, almost always it is dysplasia. It's not invasive tumor. We may have severe dysplasia at times, but invasive carcinoma, if it is there, it can be one of the two situations. One is your clinical judgment is not correct about identifying the clinically identifiable tumor margin. So the clinical judgment is wrong. Or second, the tumor, when it is being sent to pathology, it is not laid out properly. Because we have to understand that once we remove the tumor margins, they just roll up. So we have to adequately unroll it and put it nicely on the filter paper and send it. So when in doubt, always, I think taking separate margins is always good. Given a hypothetical situation that invasive tumor is still there at the margin, then probably the role of topical treatment is not justified. Only if it is still dysplasia or even carcinoma in situ, we would consider topical treatment. If there is invasive tumor, it is best that we go ahead either with plaque radiotherapy at the surgical area and little beyond, or repeat tumor margin excision again.
And similarly, for mild dysplasias, our cryo would have taken care of it. So in those cases also, we need not do anything, right?
Correct. So at least what I follow is whenever it is mild to moderate dysplasia at the margins, and we have done a double freeze thaw cryotherapy, and no clinically visible tumor, either on slit lamp examination or on post-operative OCT, if there is no tumor, then I would just observe. But if there is severe dysplasia or carcinoma in situ at the margins, then I would go for topical treatment. And of course, base, we always do plaque radiotherapy.
Thank you, Swati. So my next question is for you, Soumya. So how do we look for human papilloma virus in this OSSN samples that we send to our pathologist, and how common it is? How common is this association?
Thanks, Anushua. So we have a surrogate marker called T16, which is like, I mean, you can have an IHC of T16, which can be done on the histopath sections, and we can look for the positivity of P16. So P16, so HPV has oncogenes E6 and 7, which neutralize the proteins P53 and RB genes. And there is, which induces an expression of P16. So P16 acts as a surrogate marker for HPV. So IHC can be done and interpreted on these particular sections. So far in all the lesions, there was about 1/3 of the cases show positivity for HPV.
Thank you, Soumya. So I will move on to my next question, which is for Swati. Swati, what is your, we know the interferons in immunosuppressed patients, the tumor regression has been reported less. Moreover, that these group of immunosuppressed patients, they have invasive squamous cell carcinoma, where again, interferons don't work. So what has been your experience of using interferon in HIV seropositive patients?
Yeah, thanks, Anna. So that's a very relevant question, especially in the era where most of the patients are being treated with medical treatment and with interferon being quite popular in many practices. Now, for us, if we look at the mechanism of action of interferon, of course, the patient has to have a good immune, the good immunity for it to have the full effect. In HIV positive patients, we understand that they are immunodeficient, obviously. But whether just being HIV positive is just one half of the story. I think what is more important is what are their, the CD20 level, the cell count. That is something that unless we look at that, we do not know their exact immune status. Whether the count is low or high, it ultimately, whether the immunity levels, it depends on that. So unless we know that, we cannot just because if the patient is HIV positive, that doesn't mean that the patient will not show good response. That is what we have seen even in our practice where, this is just based on whether the patient is positive or negative, but not taking into account the other cell counts. So in those cases, we have seen that even though they are HIV positive, they do show good response. I'm talking of non-invasive types, because invasive types, we don't even want to indicate or use medical treatment in them. So they do show a good response as well. So ultimately, I think the cell counts are the ones which come into play. And at this point of time, we do not have any specific study which has correlated the cell counts and the HIV status and studied the immune response. But that would be something interesting to look at.
Thank you, Swati. So my next question is, we in this particular IC, we have not discussed about the chemotherapeutic agents in OSSN like 5-FU or mitomycin C. So what has been your experience in chemotherapy versus interferon?
Yeah, so more and more now, I think after the pandemic situation started, because of the situation, we had to kind of change our treatment a little bit. Previously, we were very high on interferons. We used to use interferon in every patient who has a non-invasive OSSN. But for the past, I would say 1.5 years or so, I have shifted to 5-FU. The only reason being because 5-FU, we know that the response is quicker, which will reduce the number of follow-up visits for the patient. Given the situation that the patient cannot come too often to us, that is the reason that we shifted to 5-FU. And we are seeing very good and quick response with 5-FU, like with interferon, what we would expect in the response to be seen in about 4 months. We see that with just one cycle of 5-FU. So it works very well. And given the situation, we have adapted to it at this point of time. And also we have tried even 5-FU in certain situations where interferon has not worked. I think one of the cases I had included in my presentation where that patient was on interferon and had undergone multiple surgeries and had tumor recurrence, which was not responding to interferon. And we changed to 5-FU and the patient showed very good response with just 2 cycles of treatment. So every form of chemotherapy, it does, chemotherapy or immunotherapy has its role. It is not that you would expect the same response in every patient. Like some patients you see like very good response with interferon with just 1 or 2 months of treatment. While that may not happen with other chemotherapy agents and vice versa. So based on how the tumor is responding, we may have to change the chemotherapy or the immunotherapy agents.
Thank you, Swati. I think that is something like I have also seen in my practice that these patients who are interferon, not responding to interferon, like after 3 months of interferon therapy, when we see there is a suboptimal response, on shifting to 5-FU or for that matter, mitomycin C has helped in these cases. But what about the side effect profile in these patients? Like few of my 5-FU patients has ended up with epithelial edema, lid edema with a, and had to stop the therapy in between. What has been your experience there?
Yeah, so now I think we haven't completed analyzing our series, but I think we would have completed treating more than 50 patients in the past 1 year. What we have seen is they do well. The side effect profile is very, very low. And the regimen that I use is 1 week on and 3 weeks off. So they get enough time of off period. And the treatment is just 1 week, which is very easy for the patient to use as well. And with that regimen, I really haven't seen much of side effect. I have only one patient who has started complaining of watering after starting 5-FU, probably some amount of canalicular and punctal inflammation it has caused. Otherwise, no serious side effects.
Thank you, Swati. So we have any of the panelists have any questions to ask?
I have a question. This is about the role of interferon in patients with xeroderma pigmentosa. And that is one situation where you would not give topical chemotherapy. So does it have a role to play in the treatment of the patient? Does it have any prophylactic role?
Yeah. Swati, will you like to take that?
Yeah, I think xeroderma pigmentosa patients, of course, as all of us know, they're very, very difficult to treat. And there has been a suggestion that they can be put on lifelong prophylaxis with interferon. But how much that is going to help, we do not have concrete data on that. So it is difficult to comment. I think these patients should be treated surgically and go ahead with most of the cases also require plaque radiation because they're quite invasive. So at this point of time, I wouldn't say that interferon can prevent recurrences in these cases.
Thank you.
So anything else from anyone? We have 1 more minute to go. If not, thank you everyone.
Yes, if you guys want, you can continue the discussion for next 2 to 3 minutes more because our next speakers won't be joining in before 10 minutes to us. So if there is some more discussion, you can go ahead with it for next 2-3 minutes.
Yeah, I think we had good discussion, but yes, Anuswa, you can take that call.
Let me check the chat box. I don't see any question there. So the question which was there, I have answered that. Okay, we can close the session now. Thank you, everyone. Thanks, Vijita, Soumya, Anirvan, Swati, for your active participation. Thank you.